So the lifestyle of a leather man. I'm more of a leather boy. I haven't seen my leather man yet. Shiny, shiny, shiny boots of leather. Whiplash, girl child in the dark. Comes in bells, your servant, don't forsake him. Strike, dear mistress, and cure his heart. Actually, being a gay leather man is about the sort of feel of leather on the skin, the smell, the actual touch and what have you, the creakiness of the leather. I do like all of that, but I also like the sort of dominance that it can bring as well within a sort of gay sort of relationship and that. It is important that you do take care of your leather because it's not a cheap product to actually buy. You can be talking about anywhere from £1,500 for a pair of jeans, especially if you have no custom made.
After the Second World War, we took up motorbiking. And I think in those days especially, people began to be interested in the leather scene because it was an antidote to what a lot of people called raving queens. They didn't want to be limp-wristed. They wanted something a bit more, if you like, manly.
As Mr. Leather Wales, I am the first title holder. We've never had a sort of Mr. Here in the leather community in Wales. And the actual sort of role of a Mr. is about sort of promotion of gay rights. It's about sort of publicising that we do have a leather community here in Wales.
I remember seeing a programme years ago and this woman wearing this full-on leather outfit. She was a villain, but she was looked so heroic and just so powerful and just so, you know what I mean? And again, I think it's just, whenever I picture myself in leather, it makes me feel like I'm some kind of superhero. Because my imagination is wild and I love superheroes, I love comics. So I feel like I'm developing a hero or something, or a villain. It's quite, because the designs of them are quite medieval and quite like heroic in some way, so it's really a lot of fun. A friend of mine got me into the pup scene. He came in with a pup hood and I was like really intrigued by him, like really like, oh, he looks so adorable. And I remember just reaching out and stroking him and he kept coming up to me and cuddling up next to me. And it was just, oh, I fell in love with it. I love that day. Because I see the pup scene as something adorable and cute, but also a place where it sort of takes you out of like the struggles and what you're living in and takes you to a good place, a place to relax and to interact.
There are a lot, often people have misconceptions. I mean, there are people who wish to be dominated, or there are people who wish to dominate. People feel that leather men are going to sort of bash you about or whatever, and that isn't the whole object at all.
I think some people may perceive the leather men as scary, but we're not, we're really not. We're really like soft, gentle people, and we're just always there to help out people my age who want to get involved in the leather scene. The community is huge. It doesn't just, you know, span in the UK, it spans, you know, across Europe, the whole world. And the one thing I noticed about it is like a second family, you could say. I mean, these people are wonderful. I mean, they always announce, you know, Miss Leather of Spain or Europe or, you know, France or anywhere. And I would love to be in those competitions, just meeting these like-minded people. I mean, I entered into the leather competition not a couple of months ago, and I never dreamed of doing that. I mean, I was so, in fact, this is what I was wearing. In fact, leather jacket, harness, and a hat, which I don't have on me today. I would never do that in a million years. But since working here, my confidence has just grown. My life has literally just changed for the better, I think.
Now, with the sort of the gay rights and all that being more open, guys do feel a lot more comfortable to be actually out in their leather. Because we've actually had it here in Cardiff over the last number of gay prides, a leather presence on that pride, it has helped the community here in Cardiff feel relaxed and comfortable with it.
Years ago, when you couldn't be openly gay, you would be arrested back in those days. And so, in the leather community or just in the gay community in general, they have colour codes. I don't know how many colours exactly, possibly 50 colours.
When I was much younger, it was about 5 colours.
The green one left side says you're a hustler, right side you're a buyer. Yellow one, left side means you give golden shower, right side you receive. The red one means...
It does cross more into the actual leather community, and we do tend to still use that cordon sort of to help guys understand really what is the preference of the individual.
A couple of my friends know, my family don't. They know I work here, but I think the reason why I haven't told them about the leather is because I don't think they'd understand, or perhaps it's because I think it's none of their business. I mean, I don't feel like I have to tell them. Maybe if they were to pop in here one day and they see me and I'm like, oh, hello, surprise.
Friends do, family don't. Family don't even know officially that I'm gay.
Nothing is really extreme. It's only extreme unless you're new to it. And then once you familiarize yourself with it, it no longer becomes extreme to you.
The incidents where someone says effing poofter or shirtlifter or whatever are relatively rare.
I've never really had a negative experience. I've had just positive, but for people from people who are familiar with the leather scene, again, working here, they look at my hood and they think, oh, you're so cute and so cool. I'm so happy for you. You've got, you know, your hood going on, your leather. But I think perhaps if I were to wear, I don't know, full-on leather outfit like Richard did, then I think I perhaps would get a positive experience like he did. I think he looks so cool. He looks like a leader or something. It's so cool. Shiny, shiny, shiny boots of leather, whiplash, girl child.